Obsessed with dimensional things, so I've been making little vases because I like to think in terms of three dimension. And here's one. And then I think they're very useful. You can put napkins in them. You can put letters in them. You know, they're useful, and they're you know, one is around the neck, one is to use. I have a lot of them. I'll show you a few.
And you actually make the buttonholes and the staples so that it can close properly.
Yeah, I make sure it has a snap. I went to buy more snaps at Michael's, and the young man did not know what a snap was. I didn't know what else to call it.
Beautifully
What do you say, a clasp?
A snap.
Snap. Snap.
They still, sewing stores still sell them.
And you also.
Sewing stores.
Yes.
You also put buttons.
I like using buttons. People
fancy
give
buttons.
Me buttons, and I've got a huge collection of buttons. We're here today because I want to show my friends how to do hooking as a craft. And I would like you to meet, first of all, Brenda Curry, as you probably all know, and also Joan Bobrecki. Who's the student?
Yes.
And I'm the hooker, Phyllis Poor. So I thought it would be interesting for people, perhaps, to hear a little bit of background on hooking, because it's an old craft. It goes back to really people in the farms would hook.
How old are we talking here?
Well,
in this country or
yes,
other countries?
This too? Country, really.
Oh.
And what happened, people on farms would take burlap, and they would take, you know, cotton or wool and strip it, and then they'd get some kind of a hook and make a rug out of it. Usually they were like pioneer types. And I remember reading once, actually, this woman made her hook. She got a potato and a nail. She bent the nail, popped it in, and that was her hook.
Hook.
I mean, these were desperate times. But then another one that's quite interesting takes place in Labrador. And this, back in the 1910, say, this guy, a missionary from England, started this thing called the Grenville Mission. And he moved to this village, and there was nobody there, and they were all having a bad time. So his wife taught the women how to hook. And they started, and it's still going on, it's called the Grenville Mission. And they would make these little things and sell them. And
oh,
the women,
my goodness.
Isn't that wonderful?
Well,
but
yeah.
The women would come, you know, from
that's
nowhere,
nice.
And suddenly they were a group together.
Oh, I like those.
And it was so inspiring. Hmm. And a friend of mine went there a few years ago, and he brought home something. So I guess it's still in existence.
Wow.
This was, but you know, it'd be like a little mat for a glass.
For tourists to pick up and...
Yeah, yeah.
And so it helped them financially.
It helped them, but it was also, I think, very social. And... well, this, for example, this is a book about American hooking, and right in the middle, they have all this stuff about the Grenville rugs that people did.
Oh, look at that.
But what is so interesting is still happening.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Isn't it? So things progress, and one thing that happened back in maybe 1950, this woman, whose name is Pearl McGowan, really helped to bring hooking up to an established craft.
And here in this area? Right?
Yes. And what happened to her? There's still Pearl McGowan hookers. And you have to be teachers, you have to do it her way. For example, this is one of her mats. Someone gave this to me and I never gave it away. But you would have, as a teacher, you would do it exactly like this. And I mean, she did huge rugs and everything. But what happened to me personally, when I moved to England, I got involved with Kay Fassett, who is actually an American living in England, and he is a colorist. He adored colors. He made it bright. He made it... Everybody just fell in love with him, and I'm one of them. For example, these are some of the things he did, believe it or not.
Oh, Oh my goodness.
Incredible. Wow. That's amazing.
And he would make, oh, maybe kits for knitting, and they'd be sort of inaccurate. He was more interested in the colors, which I found very inspiring. And then, just as an example, here's another Kay Facet.
I like that book.
They're all the same. Fabulous.
Oh, wow.
But he lived his art, which I think is very important.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And then another woman I met there while I was in England, her name is Candice Baruth, and she wrote books with him. Mm-hmm. And my neighbor, who was phenomenal, took me to her house. It was in a little village. This was her kitchen.
Oh, wow.
This goes back to 1990. And this was the living room. I almost passed out when I went in.
Wow.
Can you imagine?
No.
Candice Baruth. By the way, another American. And then this is where she lived. She signed this for me. It was a church.
Oh, wow.
And she converted it into a home. She wrote me letters after. I mean, she just wonderful people. And then, I don't know, you might like to look at this. It's just, again, another, I have a million hooking books. But
so you got started when?
I got started back in the 80s. I always had done, you know, embroidery and stuff, and
the usual.
I never, yeah, gave it credit. And when I got to England, crafts are considered a true art form. They're respected.
As opposed to here.
Yeah, where it was like grandma's work. So I got very involved with hooking. And when I came back to America, I joined up with Hookers. This is a hooking magazine that one couldn't get. It's a really a big association all across...
Here in the States.
All across America, people do it, yes. So it's always good to know. But there's one other thing I'd like to share, and then I'll do a little time teaching. With this hooking today, we cannot use burlap. It just doesn't last. So I recommend the Door Mill, which is in Guild, New Hampshire. And you can order linen.
And that's specially made for that.
Yes, it's meant for this, and it works, and it lasts.
Because I can see the little holes.
Yes, you get little holes.
And so, yeah, through the light you can see it.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
And it really works. And I put a little tape on the side, because otherwise it will get a little threadbare.
So are you saying that people hook rugs, whole rugs?
Yes, mostly. Yarn. People give me yarn. I buy yarn. It's colorful. You can buy a nice one skein. If you're doing knitting, you got to get 5 skeins, you know. So it's a little bit freeing. Then other people love to give me bits of yarn, fabric, which I put on the back. And I'm grateful. And, you know, it works.
So you back it after you finish.
What you do, you use... here we go. Tapestry thread, which is Michael's.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, you can, when you finish a little hunk, you cut it, turn it over, and sew it with that thread.
Okay.
And the thing that's so interesting, I remember reading, yarn, when you do this, it's like a pine needle. Everything flows together, including the thread, so it won't show.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay. The other thing that you will get through a door mill are hooks. And then the other thing you would need would be hoops.
Hoops and hooks.
And it's the right place to get them. They're sturdy and they last. For example, the one I'm using is not good. Well, I'm just going to show you because it's small. But it's not a good quality. I got that at Michael's. They don't work. Mm-hmm. As well as when you're a real
worker. Oh, as these do?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, this is much heavier.
Yes,
oh, yeah.
And it's more stable.
Oh, what a difference.
Yeah. Oh, feel the difference, yeah.
Right.
Sure.
And these are all the same size.
So are the hooks all the same size?
They have different size hooks.
Yeah.
I ordered these and they sent them. So I got about a dozen, so I thought, well, we'll just use them. I really prefer it slightly longer, but it does work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's the story there. And then... for this, I've gotten obsessed with making little ones. So what am I going to do with these? Well, if you make one, you can put it under a vase or under a coffee mug or something. Or you can do this. You can make a lot of them.
I love that.
Sew them together. and have a table mat.
But you've made pocketbooks and stuff out of all this.
Right.
I'll show, yes, maybe later you'll see some of the few of the things I've made. It does go on and on. This one is fun. Actually, this is little squares.
And then you've got hooks on the top.
Yeah, and then you put it over a door frame. It gives it a little style, you know, gives you fun.
And you use a sparkling yarn.
Somebody gave it to me.
Oh.
Yep. It doesn't quit.
You get the word out.
But I like to do things that are useful. Personally, I do make pillows, handbags, little bags to put maybe you want to put your cell phone in it.
I could use one of those.
Sometimes I make little owls, you know, little vases.
The owl's cute.
And isn't that fun? He's a little baby. He's got a brother and sister, a mommy and daddy in the other room.
I think your color is absolutely fabulous. Mm.
That makes me happy because to me it is about color.
That's adorable.
Ding ding.
Well, turn around the guy. Turn him around.
Doot doot. That is so cute.
There is a funny little story with this. My daughter, who lives in California, got involved. She wanted some of these. And she's become a member of an owl society that's international. So she asked me if I would make a couple of little for some guy, I think he's in Holland, and his friend. So I did, and he was very happy. Obsessions. And then the other thing I do make, too, are neck scarves. Because you know how nice it is to have a neck?
Yes.
Cozy.
Wow.
So it doesn't quit.
That's a good idea.
So the neck scarf actually has a button on it, right?
Yeah, I have a ton of buttons. I think a button is like a punctuation.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I'm very apt to do is a frame, because that brings you right into the picture that you have. And so anyway, this is the last thing I made, one of those table mats.
Oh, that is beautiful.
I like this.
So you kept it as a circle.
That's gorgeous.
Yes. And handbag.
Oh, here we go.
Doo-doo.
I love your handbags.
I think... A handbag is your identity, and I think it's the only thing we have that should be personal.
Yes.
You know, it's what you, everything you own is in your handbag.
So anyway. You just seam them, stitch them together?
Well, I made it like this, big, and then I sewed them together.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
On that one. But I vary it. And I got sort of obsessed with vases, a little.
Oh, that's cute.
Little flowers. I like making my own designs. I don't want to use another person's pattern. And when I make a design, I keep it fairly fluid so I can go out of the lines. And this girl already gets it. She's already into it. So if there are no...
So are there people who do make, draw out very designy pictures and then fill it in,
right.
As opposed to you who are kind of using your imagination?
I do, but I want to be respectful of the craft and the age of it and the history of it. But I do like it to be personal. I mean, let's do it our own way. What the heck?
But I assume some people don't.
Oh, very, very firm. You'll find that in that magazine.
Okay.
I think I showed you this, I'm not sure, but the association. And you get ideas from it, and they often will have I guess I took it out, but they'll have something in it that you can use as a pattern. But people are very flexible, and it's fun to see what everyone does. And you can see they've used a different quality. They've used...
So I see these are flowers. That's
one of the left
lower
ones.
Yeah,
interesting.
And then they can use strips of cotton or wool. But I find a yarn for me is perfect. Gosh, I've got enough of it.
Oh, look at this one. They do landscape designs.
Why not, you know?
That's pretty amazing. Too bad I lost it.
Oops, it'll show. It'll come.
So this is the equipment that you need.
That's exactly right.
Talk about creative. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's so inspiring, really.
So many ideas.
And I love the zebra.
I like that one.
I like the musical one.
Would you like to have two copies? I have so many.
Whatever. Oh, look.
Very elaborate.
Okay.
Well, we've got to have this one.
Oh. Landscape.
Wow.
I wonder how long something like that takes.
But
wow.
You know,
look at the detail.
Obsession.
Wow.
But I have one sad story. I remember reading, this woman was making a rug, and she was elderly, getting older, and she had to move into a smaller space. By the time she finished the rug, it was too big for where she lived.
Oh my God.
And I thought, you know, I'm never going to do that. I'm going to use small, useful, wearable things that, you know, I won't get stuck. But if you start when you're young,
you have a lifetime.
You have a lifetime. Any other questions, or shall we get on to teaching hooking? Mm. Ready to learn?
Hooking 101.
Hooking 101. Now, first of all, you have to have a good backing. And I think I've mentioned it has to be now linen.
And a good loom.
And you can get your hoop, your backing, and your hook. I suggest Door Mill. It's the only place I know. It's called Door Mill Store, and it's in Guild, Maine. And you can order stuff or go out. I've been up there. It's fun. They take care of all kinds of creative things. But I just call them, and I get it in the mail.
They send it to you.
They do. And I have a lot of hooks. But basically, this is your hook, and you hold it this way so that the little hook is going to go into the linen. And then underneath, after you've got it on a hoop, you have a piece of yarn, I do, and it should be approximately, like the length of your arm is plenty long. So I will show you. I will hold my hook like this. I will hold my piece like this. My piece of yarn goes underneath very close to the surface. My hook goes in straight.
Can you see it when you're looking?
I feel it.
You feel it.
Yeah, and I pull up little loops like this.
So it comes right through.
Right through, and they join each other like a pine cone. And they can be tight, and it's pretty quiet, and you can carry it around. But what I want to show you, if you do something you don't like, watch. Don't worry. It's gone, it's quiet, and you can start something else. So don't.
That is fabulous.
That is great. I'm glad you showed that.
That's fabulous.
Yeah. So now I'm going to try again. And I would like Joan to try too. She's got yarn, she's got a hook, she's got a hoop, and she's got her linen. And she's got a pattern. But what I like to do, I make my own patterns. I made one for her. And we can go out of the lines. We can fool around a little bit with it, or we can follow it. It's totally personal.
So the color you choose is whatever you feel
it's your choice, good. Exactly. And
so tell us about the yarn, the certain yarn you would or wouldn't
okay,
use.
Now what I like with the yarn, and I get, believe me, I get so much yarn from lovely people, and I want to respect it. It's so nice of them when they give you their grandma's yarn and so forth. I like wool, but I'm more interested in color. If it's a gray color, I'll go out of the way and use it. If it's a piece of, sometimes it's ribbon.
Oh, you can use ribbon?
I do. Oh. I wouldn't use a lot of it, but I might use like a little point of interest.
You mean thin ribbon?
Thin ribbon, yeah. Mm. Or sometimes it'll have a little design on it or something. But
that's a good idea.
Yeah.
You know, here and there. Primarily, this is good stuff. It's wool. Nice colors. Here's an example of what I chose because I like the color. It's not a good quality, but, you know, I might do like a center of a flower or something. It's not too important.
So it doesn't work as well.
It doesn't really grab like we like it to.
To make a topping.
Yeah, exactly.
It won't hold.
Right,
yeah.
That's right. But that's life in the hooking world. But are there any questions or anything I've left out?
So how long does it take you to do, say, finish that?
Well, what?
How often do you work at it?
This is what I do personally. I take it with me. If I go in to watch a program on television, guess what comes with me? My quiet hook.
And you come to a meeting sometimes, you have it with you too.
And if I go on an airplane or a train, I can hook. However, I was once on an airplane and they took away my hook.
They took your hook?
Oh, wow. Yes.
And I'm looking over at a woman wearing shoes with like the heels like this, and I thought, that's more dangerous than my little hook. But when I got off, I said, do you think I could have it back? And I got it back. Because I was going to be away a while, and I was anxious to have my hook.
That is very strange.
Yeah. Live and learn, huh?
So you have to have a hook at the other end.
That's it. Or you have to leave it in your bag. Don't try to carry it on. But, yes, I do it. You know, it's quiet. It doesn't bother anybody. You can set it down. And
it's not heavy.
This would take me... It probably would take me a couple of weeks putting it up and putting it down. Truthfully, I'd probably do it faster than that. But there is no hurry.
No.
You know, you do
and
what you
do.
And
it doesn't have to wait like a painting to dry or any of that
right.
kind of stuff.
And you just have a few little rules and then you can break them. And what I like to do is make something I can give as a gift. Something someone will say, oh, thank you. I can wear that.
Yeah. And you have. Bought pocketbooks and...
Yeah, it's just my passion.
And you can exhibit it at an art association fair
and
as a craft.
And then yeah. Now crafts are considered a serious form of art, really. Yeah. You know, quilting and knitting and so forth. But I like this one, so I hope you do too, ladies and gentlemen.
It's very impressive.
Oh, thank you, my girl. I think I've covered pretty much everything.
How many years have you been doing it?
Well, I started doing it in the 80s when I was in England. I was living in England, and they were very respectful of it. And, of course, I got nuts over the colors that Kay Fassett pushed and helped. To this day, he does. And he does give talks over here in this country. But
it's very interesting because I don't think most people know about that.
No,
that's true.
Funny? I started with embroidery and knitting and, you know, playing with yarn, but I didn't take it seriously until I got to England. But there's one little thing I'd like to say. It's a quote I read. You love what you find time to do. Mm. Isn't that
you
the
make
truth?
Time to do
yes,
it.
Yes, if you love it.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. But
but it's so interesting because it's not that popular here.
No.
But there are associations, you tell us.
That are international. You know,
Hookers Association.
Yeah. My grandmother taught me to knit, and I thought that was fun. You know, I like playing with fabric. I always have. And, I studied art, but I didn't take myself seriously through college. I was a teacher. And on the side, I would do stuff, knit. Crochet, you know, whatever. And then it became, I wanted to do something that I could do at home that wouldn't be a big deal. I didn't want to have a big loom or anything like that. And that's when I started with doing this.
Because the big loom really takes up a lot of time, a lot of space.
Yeah, and you can't.
And it's really hard. Yeah,
you can't take it with you.
You can't take it with you when you go.
This is portable.
This is
well, I don't know if you can see up there, but that was during my... cross stitch stage embroidery.
So you were serious about embroidery.
But I didn't take it seriously. I thought it was just me, you know.
But you prefer this now.
This is all I do now. I am committed.
I can see how it's much easier and to work with.
Isn't it?
Yes.
And you can correct mistakes.
Yeah, I love that. I've done a lot. I was at DeCordova. I gave talks in Curry Museum, and I forget where it is, down there, far away, and just all around, some places in Lowell.
Lowell has a big art center,
yes,
so with that,
I was part
this
of that
is one
for
of,
a while,
yeah.
Yes. Yeah, local, you know, pretty much around here. I'm in Connecticut, in Old Saybrook, there's a museum there, but that was in the past. I always taught it. And I had a huge show in Watertown at the, I think it's called...
Arsenal.
Arsenal. And it was so exciting to see all my stuff out of the house in one place, you know. It was very thrilling, and I'm very grateful.
Do you have much stuff left now, or does it all get given and sold?
Oh, my house, well, my so-called studio is loaded.
Really?
I must have 100 pillows around the house.
Wow.
Pillows are for sale?
Anything, sale, giveaway.
Where can people go to, what craft fairs do you do?
I'm pretty much down to doing the one at St. John's Episcopal Church. They do it twice a year. Oh. People come over and they'll ask me if I can buy something. I say sure. There was a woman who has a shop in it's next to Trader Joe's I guess it's
Isabel. Oh, then Susan took us too.
Yes. And she took some of my bags.
She has a shop that she buys very high-end clothing at the end of the season, very high-end. And she has a little shop, and she opens once a week on a Saturday. And you can go in there by appointment and buy her clothes. Mm-hmm. And she liked her. She was wearing it.
Yeah.
And she said, I'll buy it.
And she did.
She came to the art festival.
She came to the art festival,
yes,
yeah.
Yes. But and then it turns out that my daughter's mother-in-law and she had a studio together in Cambridge, so they know each other. And she said, that looks like Phyllis's purse. Another one of those
crazy
connections, yeah. But I think now I'm more apt to stay at home and carry on here. I know there were other places in Boston, but you kind of forget. The joy is in doing it. It's a pleasure for me, and I think it's so nice of you to let me talk about it.
The pandemic has been tough for a lot of people.
Truly.
It's forced people to stay in, and maybe more people are taking up crafts. You know?
Yeah.
Can you talk about the designs that you...
What I do is make my own designs. I want it to be personal. I think art should sort of represent the artist. So, for example, I just did this one. I think I showed you this, did I? And it's about color, you know.
Oh, that's nice.
But everyone could do whatever they want.
They
if they
should
want
do
to copy it. Something, they could
totally.
Do that.
Totally. I don't have any problem with that. I like people to do their thing, and I want to do mine. And I use, a Sharpie, black, make a design somehow.
And there's a design.
Oh, here's an example. And then go a little crazy with the color. And then I'm going to put these all together ultimately when I have about 8 or 9 and make a little map probably, something like that. Maybe I'll buy hers. And that will be another little thing which I'll have probably. I'll do the show at St. John, the Episcopal Church is in April, so I'll probably have a few things there.
Anyone could come.
Anyone's welcome, of course.
Well, I think the pillows are really nice because on someone's living room or dining room, they're in the corner and they're very colorful and they fit into whatever it is.
And they're portable. You know,
and they're portable, lightweight.
And I have all sizes in pillows. I just brought out this one.
I love that one.
Yeah. They're all beautiful. And you can pick whatever color you want.
Yeah. The pillows are kind of wonderful. They fit in your bag. They are good. Yeah. I agree.
I have one of her pillows in my rocking chair in the living room.
Good.
And it's so
See?
Beautiful to look at. It's just so bright.
And it's movable. You know, you don't have to, you're not stuck.
And are your pillows different sizes or are they all the same?
No.
That's a little larger than the one I have. Yeah.
I have a lot of them in the living room and now in the other room where I have all my stuff.
Okay.
More stuff, huh?
Yeah, more stuff.
You have to look at your stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, this is my first time trying to hook.
Yes.
And,
you were a willing candidate.
Phyllis gave me one of her designs, and I'm just filling it in.
Can you imagine for the first time, look how she selected colors that support each other. And this is an example, perfect, of how they fit together and they squeeze together. She got it right away.
It's a lot of fun. I can't wait to
do
it. Absolutely, yeah. I mean, everyone needs something creative to do, and I've been looking for something to do.
We can do it together. Yeah, you can
right.
come over and hook.
And then, I think the show and tell, and I think it's really good because you're showing another craft to people who don't know about
you're
it.
You're sharing, yes.
And everyone's looking for something to do, something that's creative.
For sure.
I think it's good.
Yeah. But I find hooking is very much like... oriental rugs. Whatever you put on it blends in. It doesn't.
That's true.
It's okay.
You know, the back is as pretty as the front.
The back is by
yes.
Kay Fassett.
Beautiful.
I love his fabric.
Oh my God, it's gorgeous.
Do you use a darning needle when you do the fabric?
Yes, I had one in here to show.
That's all your equipment.
That's right.
It doesn't have a lot. It can fit in your pocketbook.
Totally. I use this kind of a needle. It's you know, you can stick the thread in easily, mm-hmm. and it could go into the linen and into the yarn comfortably. It's not as easy as it used to be to get particular wool. So I go by color and feel, and I go and look it over and when I'm in
the
shop.
So the thicker the piece is, the better.
Yes. Well, I don't want it to be too thick, but I want it to have resistance, resilient. Oh. Like this has resistance.
And the yellow doesn't.
The yellow doesn't. No,
the yellow but you can feel. Hard.
But my thing is that I have so much from people that are so generous. For example, this is a little thicker.
Yeah. That's too thick?
It's not, I'll do it.
But it's really not.
It's a bit thick.
It's a bit thick.
I'm not, I'm more open than I used to be because people are so generous. And you can't get such great stuff in the stores like you used to. Now, I mean, it'll happen again. To me, it's color.
Does it have to be wool?
Should be, but I've gone off and used a bit of other stuff here and there. But I prefer wool. Mm-hmm.
So the original is wool.
True. Mm-hmm. Well, the original really is people stripping away.
Yeah, back on the farm.
Yeah.
And using whatever they had.
And a lot of people to this day, and I was one of them, would strip of cotton and wool fabric. But then I thought, you know what?
You could buy an old sweater and take it apart.
Or I had old sweater, yeah. But it's they want a more of a cotton fabric or a woolly mm-hmm. fabric. And I thought, I have wool. I mean, yarn is available.
Right.
Do you ever use alpaca or any of those?
Oh, I love that. Alpaca's terrific. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, I have a lot of that.
Oh, that sounds...
Well, I was thinking of sometimes, for example, if you go to the MFA in the gift shop, you'll find some hooking things there.
Oh, I didn't have that.
Occasionally. Mm-hmm. And other museums, for example, the Fuller Museum in Brockton's a good possibility. And...
maybe the PEM might have something.
Yes, that's true. The PEM do. They do. And then there's another one. Oh, the De Cordova.
Oh.
Had some, too. It's always worth looking, asking.
That.
But I think the MFA is the most consistent.
All right.
So I think about it. But I'm going to try some local places, too.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I think it's time to reach out.
Yeah, people need to see.
Yeah. It's not often in crafty magazines, I will say that. I don't know why, but it's not.
Because I had never seen it. Until I met you, I had no idea.
No, I always look, and I don't find it so much. But once people get into it, they do become, as we say, hooked.
Hooked.
Truly, if anyone wants information or a quick lesson or anything, I am available. And when I was living in Bath, my daughter's husband was a student at Oxford. And I went to the Oxford Museum, and they had this thing about a bowerbird, and the bowerbird, the male, would set up this beautiful bower, something to attract the female, and it would be beautiful colors. It might be broken glass, it might be rocks, it was anything he could find, and it was beautiful, and that was on display there. And then I've read about it since, and this is true. This is what the bowerbird does. He sets up a home for her, and she falls for it, and I thought, that is amazing. And I saw it once again in Cambridge, the Harvard Museum there had a whole thing about the bowerbird. So I've used that as my reference all these years. Let's see if there's anything else. The other thing that I keep fussing with is the chain. Because some people say, oh, I want one that goes over my head.
Right, crossbody.
So then I have to switch it, you know. But I'm willing, I don't mind. Whatever, as they say. And,
oh, I like this.
You know, this is like a neck piece, scarf. My friend over there has one.
And then, oh, you got all these birds.
Birds and owls. Yeah. For kids, you know.
Very cute.
I'm a kid.
That's always fun. Forever a kid.
Thousands of these things. Here. So, all over the place.
Oh, here's something that might be of interest.
This is nice.
This is the first thing I ever made.
Very nice.
I never got rid of it.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Wow.
That one on the end I just did recently.
The one on the left?
Yes. And I don't know, it just came to me. It just happened. It evolved, if you know what I mean.
So everything here evolves.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Phyllis, did you go to art school?
I did study art in college, and but then I ended up in early childhood. I've kind of regretted it. I think I would have liked teaching art. But, you know, you don't always make great decisions. But this actually is something I made in honor of, we called Aunt Peg. She was a patient of my husband's, and we got involved with her, and she was marvelous. She lived with us for a long time. And I did this kind of in her honor when she died, because she had a book that her former husband had made with birds in it, very similar. So we kind of keep it as a memory.
And then this one.
And that was going to be a handbag. And my daughter said, why don't you hang it? So I said, oh, okay. And I did. And I kind of find it interesting. I don't remember why I did that, but I decided it needed to be framed. So I did. And this one was felting, which I don't do anymore. Someone gave me that bench, and I made the top four, hooked it, and then there was a nice guy in Concord who put it together for me. But I used to find chairs and do them on the street, and pillows. You know, it just went on and on. And of course, there are probably 25 pillows in this room. And then I think finally, I'll just mention again scarves. I like
those are nice.
Comfort of scarves.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And scarves, yes. So I think other than that, you've covered the whole topic, and I think you've been a wonderful audience. I can't thank you enough.
This has been wonderful.